Hallelujah. Good morning, everyone. It's nice to be here again this morning. My name is Shade Oyediran. Before I start to share with us in the Word of God, I just want us to sing a song of worship to the Lord. Hallelujah. The song goes like this. Worthy, 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 worthy is the Lamb that was slain for you and me. Holy, 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 holy. Holy is the Lamb, is the Lamb that was slain for you and me. Elohim, Holy One, Righteous One, Faithful God, Governor among the nations, He's the Lamb. Worthy, 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 He's the Lamb. He's the was slain for you and me. Holy, 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 holy. He's the Lamb, He's the Lamb that was slain for you and me. We say powerful, merciful, wonderful, wonderful, He's the Lamb, He's the Lamb that was slain for you. Hallelujah. Holy and worthy is the Lamb of God that was slain for you and me. If not for Jesus Christ, I would not be here this morning. But for what Jesus Christ did, I'm able to be here this morning. So I want to say thank you to you, Lord, for giving yourself, for dying in my place. Thank you, Father, Lord, for taking my place. We thank you, O Lord, for washing away our sins, for giving your life so that we might live. Father, we say thank you for giving your Son. Thank you, Father. Lord, as we go into your word this morning, we pray that you minister to us, O Lord, once again. Let there be life. Let the word transform. Let the word change us. Let there be understanding of your word this morning. In Jesus' name. Hello, once again. I just want to share with us in the book of Acts of the Apostle, chapter 12. The topic today is, who will pray for me? Who is praying for you? And who is praying for me? But this, I want to direct my exhortation today to all Christians. To all Christians. We send people to the field and we forget them there. Well, you might say, I didn't send anyone to the field. They are called by God. God sent them to the field. Yes. But they are part of the kingdom and they are sharing the word of God. And whatever we are doing in the kingdom, I believe we are doing it together. If we are in the same kingdom, whatever we are doing for God, we should do it together. I want to talk about the missionaries that are in the field and the pastors that are exposed to arrows, to different kind of things, and we leave them and we forget to pray for them. Some churches will send missionary. Once they send them and give them money, some won't even, they won't even do anything again. They won't even ask after them again. They don't care what is happening to them in the field. Whether they eat, whether they don't eat, whether they send their children to school or not, they don't care about their children. I remember my sister. 1 year, when was stolen for almost 6 months. And they were just believing God to stop this stealing. You see, these people, they are open to a lot of attacks in the field. But we refuse to pray for them. We just live there. Sometimes when we give them money, we just believe that, yes, I've done my part. Once I've given you money, that is all. But that is not all, brethren. I want us to see what happened in the book of Acts chapter 12. And let us learn from this today and take up this responsibility to begin to pray for the missionaries on the field. I want to read from Acts chapter 12. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched out his hand to arouse some from the church. Then he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And because he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to seize Peter also. Now it was during the days of unleavened bread. So when he had arrested him, he put him in prison and delivered him to 4 squads of soldiers to keep him, intending to bring him before the people after Passover. Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. And when Herod was about to bring him out, that night Peter was sleeping, bound with 2 chains between 2 soldiers and the guards before the door were keeping. Now, behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise quickly." And his chains fell off his hands. Then the angel said to him, "Guard yourself and tie on your sandals." And so he did. And he said to him, "Put on your garments and follow me." So he went out and followed him, and did not know that what was done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. When they were past the first and the second guard post, they came to the iron gate that leads to the city, which opens to them of its own accord. And they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. And when Peter had come to himself, he said, "Now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angels and has delivered me from the hands of Herod and from all the expectations of the Jewish people." Amen. Amen. This is what happened. The Bible says, after the enemy was succeed, killing one of the disciples, he decided to lay hands on Peter again. You see, a lot of brethren in the north, they are facing a lot of challenges. But because some of us, because we are not in the north, we neglected them and we are not praying for them. A lot of missionaries, they are in so many unreached areas just to make sure that the gospel reach these people. They are working day and night. Some of them, they find it difficult to even send their children to school. Some of them, some of these missionaries, they are even taking care of the missionary that has gone very far into the deep villages where you and me cannot reach. They are taking care of their children so that they can go and take care of the missionaries, of the people that have not heard about the gospel. Here in the Bible says Herod laid hands on Peter and they put Peter in the prison. We're going to learn about ourselves today as well. We're going to learn some things about ourselves as well. No matter what you are going through, maybe the enemy has laid hands on you and you are in the prison. I don't know the kind of prison where you find yourself today, because you are working for God, because you are doing something that is right, because you are doing what God has called you to do. Sometimes because God has called you, it doesn't mean that you will not feel opposition. I don't know whom you are representing where you are. Maybe you are representing God where you are working. And because you are doing something that is right, and because you are doing what God has called you to do, you are facing oppositions. And it's like you are in the prison of your own. I want to tell you this morning that the power that removed Peter, divine intervention that Peter encountered, will be your own today in the name of Jesus Christ. The Lord God will visit you in your prison and let you out by divine intervention. I want us to see what happens here. You see, naturally, if people are being imprisoned, they don't come out until they order for them to come out, until maybe they give them access, because most of the time they are chained. Sometimes the prison doors are locked, and so they cannot come out just of their own. So was experience of Peter. He couldn't come out of his own. In fact, he was sleeping. That shows the peace even in the time of storm. I don't know what you are going through. Do you have this kind of peace that Peter has, that he was able to sleep even in the prison? What are you going through? Stop going helter skelter. Stop running all over the place. Let God give you divine intervention. Let God give you divine help, like he did for Peter. Peter has rest, has his peace, even in time of storm. He was sleeping. And like I said, except maybe they bring you out for hearing, you can't come out. Especially when they are already planning to kill you. Herod was still going to bring out Peter for hearing. But God intervened. I remember the message that my pastor preached sometimes ago. A night before miracle happened to Peter here. And that was when Abacha was dealt with before he wanted to kill people. That was Pastor Bakari I'm talking about. And in this place, Herod was still going to bring out Peter for hearing. So that people will say, you know, when you are in the midst of people that don't like you, people that are opposed you, what do you expect? He was just going to keep Peter for hearing so that they will kill him and stone him the same way they did to Stephen, and the same way he has killed one of the disciples. But God intervened. What happened? The Lord sent forth his angel to set Peter free. Why was Peter was set free. Where was he free? How did he get his freedom? The Bible recorded that the apostles and all the people that has given their life to Jesus Christ, they were praying earnestly for Peter. The Bible says they offered certain prayers. That is, they prayed a kind of prayers that the hand of God was touched. And God said, oh, there must be an intervention. And God sent forth his angel to rescue Peter. Where are you this morning? God is going to rescue you. There will be a divine intervention to bring you out of your problems in the name of Jesus, to bring you out of your prison like God did. What happened here? The Bible recorded that there were guards. There were guards. In fact, the Bible says there were two standing beside Peter. What happened to them? What happened to those guards? What happened to those people that were monitoring Peter? I want to say to you, it doesn't matter. Let them be monitoring you. Let them be monitoring your life. Let them be following you about. Let them even restrain you. There's going to be an intervention, a divine intervention, that will put them to sleep. And God will set you free. And God will let you go. This was what happened to Peter. They were there, standing, guiding. That we're going to see how he will come out of here. As if they knew that the God that Peter served is a God that does not need their key to open the door. And so they were monitoring him closely so that he would not be able to leave. But lo and behold, they waited in vain. They stood there in vain because God did his miracle. He rendered them paralyzed and they were just sleeping. And they did not know how it happened. And Peter was rescued. And the Bible says, after Peter was rescued, they were going. The Bible says, recorded, that they passed two guards, two men. You see, sometimes when you are still fighting flesh, when you are fighting flesh, because the Bible recorded that they passed two men, which I understood by interpretation of God, which are the level that is still the level of flesh that they can overcome by themselves. They said they passed two people. Maybe in your problems, you are able to overcome two obstacles and you get to this particular one and it's like, how am I going to really overcome this? No. It looks as if this is the dead end. The Bible says after they left those two people, the guards, two guards, they go to a particular gate. They said this gate was an iron gate. I want you to know that gates represent powers, authorities that the enemy has set so that you will not gain your freedom. That you might have passed those two levels, those two obstacles that your flesh can dealt with. But now this is what it takes the Spirit of God himself to deal with. The Bible says they pass those two gates. Then they get to this iron gate that looks as if they cannot overcome. But the Bible says it was this iron gate that was the most easiest thing for Peter. What happened? The Bible recorded that these gates opened of his own accord. Hallelujah. 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 The gate opened of his own accord. I want to say to you this morning that problem that you think is so difficult, especially the missionaries that are on the field,
that you, I don't know what you are facing. I don't know the kind of problem that you are going through, that it looks as if this is the end. We are packing it up. We are coming back home. We are not going to do this work anymore. I don't want you to do that, because there's going to be a divine intervention for you. The same way that God set Peter free when he got to the iron gate, that looks as if I don't think we can overcome this. This is where the enemy will catch us. No. Your God is not asleep. If you have overcome the two guards, no matter how strong this gate is, there is a God that does not need the key before he enters. It's called omnipresence. It's called omniscience. The God that can open the door, no matter how strong they are, no matter how big the gate is, no matter how strong the gate is, that is the God that I've brought to you this morning. That is the God that I've come to tell you that is able to make you surmount that mountain in the name of Jesus Christ. I don't want you to be discouraged, you missionaries on the field this morning. The Lord is going to make a way, because we are going to pray for you this morning, and we will continue to pray for you. And so, brethren, I want to tell you that we have to continue to pray for these brethren, because this is what the Christians were doing. Immediately Peter was captured, they started to pray. They begin to pray. The Bible says they offered certain prayer that touches the heart of God. Certain prayer that touches the hand of God. Certain prayers that makes God to move on behalf of Peter and send help. God is going to send help to you in what you are going through this morning. I don't care how big that mountain is. I don't care how strong that gate is. The Lord is going to pull them down this morning. In fact, they are going to open of their own accord. I don't know the door that has been shut against you, whether in this country or anywhere. I don't know the door that has been shut against your promotion. I don't know the door that has been shut against your children. I don't know the door that has been shut against your husband. I don't know the door that has been shut against your family. I want to tell you this morning, there is a God that can speak to the gate and make the gate to open of his own accord this morning. That gate is opening for you. 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 I declare in the name of Jesus that every gate that has been shut against your life, every gate that has been shut against your destiny, every gate that has been shut against you in life, they will open of their own accord, because there's a divine intervention to let you go. The Bible says Herod was still waiting for the next day, but God surprised him by letting Peter free. Amen. You are free in the name of Jesus. I declare that you are free in the name of Jesus. And so, I want to encourage you to continue to pray for missionaries. I don't want you to leave them. I don't want you to just neglect them. Yes, you've given your money. Some of you have not even given your money, and yet you don't offer prayers. The Bible says they offered certain prayers, and we are going to pray this morning. And so I want you to lift up your voice to every missionaries that you know, that they are on the field. I want you to begin to pray for them, that the Lord will offer, we raise helpers of destiny for them and their children. Whatever it is that is in their heart that they wanted to do and they are not able to do, that the Lord this morning will cause them to have peace even in what they are going through, like Peter has peace. Peter was sleeping even in a time of problem. Father, in the name of Jesus, lift up your voice and begin to pray for all these missionaries, that the Lord will raise them helpers in the name of Jesus. Father, we commit all the missionaries into your hands, oh Lord God, especially those in the field. Lord, we pray for them all, whether all over the world, We pray for all the missionaries that, Lord, you will strengthen them, that at this time they will not be weak. As many of them that are wearied in their heart, as many of them that are lacking, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we pray that you will raise helpers of destiny for them. You will meet them at the point of their need. You will encourage them this morning, even in what they are going through, in the name of Jesus Christ. As many of them that want to reach out, even to many people, but they are not able to reach out, Father, we pray today for them, that you will open doors unto them, all the doors that are shut against them. Lord, we pray that all these doors will begin to open of their own accord in the name of Jesus. You will make a way for them where there's no way, in the name of Jesus Christ. The same way, oh Lord, that you let Peter out, oh Lord God, you will let them out of every prison that they are in the name of Jesus Christ. Maybe some of them are even captured by people right now and they are about to kill them. You are the mighty God. You, the same God that put all those guards to sleep, and you brought out Peter on hot. Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that you begin to put their enemies to sleep, and in the name of Jesus Christ, you begin to send them helpers. You begin to bring them out of every problems that they are going through, in the name of Jesus Christ. I want you to pray for as many of them that are sick right now, that the Lord will heal them, that the Lord will send forth his hand and he will heal them according to his word. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray for all the missionaries that are sick, oh Lord God, at this very time, oh Lord, we pray for them, that Lord, you will send forth your healing hand upon them in the name of Jesus Christ. Let the Son of Righteousness arise in his healing wings in the name of Jesus. Let the life of these people be touched, oh Lord God. Heal them in their spirit, heal them in their soul, heal them in their body, in the name of Jesus Christ. I want you to pray again for them. The Bible says the chains in the hands of Peter fell off without the keys. Maybe you've been struggling with that chain. I want to tell you this morning, the Bible says the chain fell off. Why? Because the presence of God was mighty even in the prison. In your prison, the Lord is going to bring forth his light. In your prison, the Lord will cause every chain that binds you, every chain that holds you, to fall off in the name of Jesus. The Bible says there was a great light even in that prison. In the prison of your life, there will be a great light. I pray this morning that the light of God will shine all over the place where these people are ministering the word of God. The light of God will shine, and every chains in the life of these people, every chains that are holding them bound, that does not allow them to hear the word of God, that does not allow them to see properly in the light of the word of God this morning, we declare that those chains will begin to fall in the name of Jesus Christ, and they will begin to see, they will gain their where they are in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for all the missionaries, oh Lord God, that are in the field. Let the light of the gospel that they are sharing, so that their chains will fall off in the name of Jesus, and they will be free at last in the name of Jesus. I want to thank you this morning, everyone that has joined me. I want to thank you. I don't want you to stop here. I want you to continue praying for all the missionaries and all the ministers of God. Yes, I talk about the missionaries because we neglect them. But what about the pastors? What about the ministers that has been ministering to us? We leave all these people to be exposed to different attacks. When a pastor falls, anytime we see any pastor falling, that is when people will begin to carry the rumors. You will not carry the rumors that you refuse to pray for them. You will not carry the rumors that you expose their life even to great attack. These people will pray for you, and all those demons that are chasing you, they begin to fall in them all over the place. And you people will forget to pray for them. So I'm challenging you today. Pray for all the ministers of God that you know. Pray for all the Christians that you know. Don't leave them. You know, sometimes we just think that because they are ministers, I want you to remember that they are still man. They're human beings like you. They need every support they can get from you. So I want you to continue praying, even me that are ministering to you this morning. I want you to continue praying for me so that this word will continue. I want you to, my pastor will always say, my mother does not raise a fool. And so
I want you to pray for me. Anytime he finished ministering, he will say, all of you, just stretch your hands to me and begin to pray. Yes, that is wisdom. You know, that is wisdom. I want you to continue praying for all the ministers. They are exposed to different dangers and attacks, even though they come boldly sometimes to declare the word of God. But they are going through a lot of things. Sometimes they don't even have anybody to share them with. I want to encourage you this morning. Please don't leave them at the battlefield. Always follow them up with prayers and encourage them. I wanted to encourage you this morning. If you know any missionaries on the field, I want you to call them. Give them a call. Calls of encouragement. Call them time to time. Encourage them in what they are doing. Tell them that the Lord is with them. The Lord is beside them. Encourage them. Send things to them. And if you don't have anything to send, give them your prayers. The Lord will bless you. I love you all. Thank you very much. Till I see you again, from me to you.